Hey guys, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. I welcome you all in this video, which will help you in cracking your RBI Grade B, NABARD Grade A and SEBI Grade A Phase 1 GK examination. So particularly this video caters to your Phase 1 GK current affairs, Phase 1 current affairs only. Okay. So on that note, let's begin this video. But before that, if you haven't subscribed our channel till now, then guys, do subscribe and hit the bell notification. And let me inform you that the PDF of this session will be provided to you on our Telegram channel. And the link of that Telegram channel is in the description below. So if you want this PDF, then you can just click on that link and join our Telegram group. Okay, so let's begin with our first question. And in today's video, we will be discussing about the 21st SEO Summit, the 22nd SEO Summit. Both the summits, I am taking the names simultaneously, but that doesn't mean that both of them have been conducted simultaneously. No. So you have to just wait for a bit that what is the 22nd summit of SEO and what are the things that we are going to cover about it. Okay, so we are going to discuss it in detail. This is our first question from the 21st SEO Summit. So which of the following is not a new entrant in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization? I'm saying which of the following is not a new entrant in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization? Iran, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Egypt, none of the above. So what do you think, guys, is the right answer? The right answer here is option A. Iran is not a new member. I hope that many of you have heard this news that Iran has been included in the SEO member groups. But does that mean that Iran is a new member? Not at all. Because Iran was there as the observer state of SEO. Therefore, Iran is not a new entrant in the SEO. However, in the members list, Iran has entered. Okay. So if you read the question carefully, then you would know that the correct answer is Iran and not any of these other options. Okay. Now, as far as the other three countries are concerned, so these three have joined as the dialogue partners of SEO. So don't worry, we will be discussing that as well. But let's first have a look at the highlights of 21st SEO Summit. So guys, Iran has joined the SEO as a member nation, as a member state. Earlier, it was the observer state and this was announced at the 21st SEO Summit. Now, the summit was the Council of Heads of State Summit. Let me clarify this thing. Do listen to me very carefully. The SEO, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, has three main organs, okay? The first one is Council of Heads of State. Second one is Council of the Heads of Government. And the third one is the SEO Foreign Ministers Council. Okay, so these are the three organs or the three bodies of SEO that conduct their summits annually. Only this, the Heads of State Wali Council conducts its summit annually and both the other organs conduct their summits frequently. Okay, so that we can say because the annual track has been maintained by this Heads of Summit Council only. Now, this Heads of State Council is the premier or the apex body of SEO that takes the major decisions related to the functioning of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Okay, and the Heads of States, which are usually the presidents of any nation, of the member nations, if we talk about the SEO. So the presidents of the member nations participate in this Council of Heads of State Summit. Now, this would be tricking your mind, right? That Prime Minister Narendra Modi has participated in this and I am saying that presidents participate in this. So guys, we are talking about the functional heads of state and India has a parliamentary democracy. So here the functional head of state is the Prime Minister and not the president. Therefore, by virtue of being the head of the state, by virtue of being the person who is in the helm of India, he participates, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi participates in the Heads of State Council Summit or the Prime Minister of India, if we put it in general terms, okay? So do remember, Head of State refers to the person who is actually heading the state, who is actually in power to head the state. Therefore, from India, Prime Minister participates. From Pakistan also, the Prime Minister of Pakistan participates because we both are parliamentary, not Pakistan is not completely that kind of a democracy, but India is. Okay. Now, in the heads of government also, the head participates, Prime Minister has participated when this took place in 2019. Okay. And this SCO, Foreign Minister Council, so it undertakes the decisions, it takes the decisions related to the day-to-day functioning of SCO and the Foreign Minister. Before this summit, some days back, the Foreign Minister of India, Jai Shankar, participated in this SCO Foreign Ministers Council, which was held in Dushanbe, Tajikistan. Okay, so that was also held in this country. I hope that this much is clear to you. Now, so this point we have already discussed. This also we have discussed that Saudi Arabia, Egypt and Qatar have joined the SCO as the new dialogue partner. And the summit was chaired by Imam Ali Rahman, who is the president of Tajikistan. Do remember the name of the president of Tajikistan, because nowadays the questions are not asked straightforward. Instead, the examiner tends to take a U-turn when it frames the question. So do remember that you have to remember the name of the president. Now guys, here is the list of, this is the updated list of the members of SCO. So here you can see there are 9 member states. Russia, China, India, Pakistan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Iran. Okay. Now, from this list only, I can frame a very tricky question for you. Can you answer it? Which Central Asian country is not a member of SCO? If you know the answer, then do mention it in the comment section below. 4 of these Central Asian countries are mentioned right in front of you. There is only one remaining, and that you have to mention in the comment section below. So this might become a static question in your RBSEB NABARD current affairs, okay, the GK portion. Next comes the observers. So Afghanistan, Belarus and Mongolia, these 3 are the observer states of SCO. Earlier Iran was also a part, but now it has gained the status of a permanent member of SCO. And these countries are the dialogue partners. Dialogue partners do not have much say in the functioning of SCO. They just attend the summits of SCO, the 3 summits that I talked about, the summits of SCO as the observers or as the dialogue partner, not the observers, as the dialogue partners. Okay. Now, since 3 new members have been added into this list, you are supposed to memorize the 9 member countries, the 9 countries which are the dialogue partners of SCO. Okay. So all these 3 lists should be memorized by you for your upcoming examination. So that was all about the 21st SCO summit. Now let's talk about the second question. Which country is the president of SCO for 2022? So during the 21st summit only, this was also announced that the next year's presidency has been handed over to Uzbekistan. Okay. And who is the president of Uzbekistan? This is your next question for the comment section. Okay. So do mention it in the comments. So Uzbekistan is going to be the president of SCO in 2022. Now, the heads of state council, whenever we talk about the SCO summit, do keep this thing in mind that we are referring to the SCO Council of Heads of State meeting that takes place annually. Okay, and this would be the 22nd edition. Edition is also important for you to remember. Now guys, the 20th SCO Council of the Heads of Government, which was to be held in 2021 or which will be held in 2021 because the dates are not announced. Okay, so this will be held in Kazakhstan. Okay, last year in 2020, November 2020, 19th SCO Council of Heads of Government meeting was organized by India, and that was the first time ever since India joined SCO in 2017 that India got the opportunity of hosting the Heads of Government meeting. Okay, and India has never hosted the Heads of State Council meeting or SCO summit in general, if you want to talk about it. Okay, so that is all about the 22nd SCO summit. Do not forget to mention your answer in the comment section below and try to memorize the facts that are mentioned here. Okay, so this is the structure that I was talking about. SCO heads of state council. So let me just read it out in a brief manner so that you can understand what function does it play in SCO. Okay. So it shall determine. So this is the supreme SCO body, and it determines priorities and define major areas of activities of the organization. It also decides the fundamental issues of its internal arrangement. So not only the major issues are tackled by this heads of state council, but the internal arrangements related to SCO, the internal functioning of SCO, is also something that is discussed in this heads of state council meeting. Okay, and its interaction with other states and international organizations, as well as consider the most important topical international issues. As you must have come across the statements made by Prime Minister Narendra Modi during this 21st SCO summit about the situation of Afghanistan, about the need for creating a cooperation in order to tackle the radicalization in the area, in the area surrounding Afghanistan, because this is one of the most contentious issues of the day because of the Taliban takeover. Okay, the next point is the SCO heads of government council. Okay, so it approves the budget of the organization, it considers and decides upon the major issues related to particular, especially economic spheres of interaction with the organization. Okay. Foreign Ministers Council, so it undertakes the issues related to day-to-day activities of the organization, preparation of the meetings of the councils of heads of states, and holding of consultation on international problems within the organization. The council may, as appropriate, make statements on behalf of SCO. So that is the functioning of SCO, Foreign Council, Foreign Ministers Council. This SCO was established in 2001 and the headquarters is in Beijing. Okay, so this is all that is important for you to know about this SCO summit. Next question is, which of the following countries hosted the 6th edition of Peaceful Mission exercise? So let me tell you, it is a bilateral exercise carried out by the armies or military forces of different countries, and those countries are not stranger countries. They are a part of an international grouping. And which group is this? That is a surprise for you. Okay. Let's first read out the options. Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, China, India, Russia. So which country hosted this peaceful mission exercise? The right answer here is Russia. Russia hosted this peaceful exercise. Okay. So this is the 6th edition, and this is the place, this is the region, Orenburg region, which is located in the southern west region of Russia. Do remember this region as well. Okay, so here this exercise is being hosted by Russia during this duration that is mentioned here. No need to memorize the dates, it is just for your information. Now, as I said, that the participating countries are not a stranded group of countries, it is a part of an organization. So which organization it is? It is SCO. Okay, so the countries which are participating are the members of SCO. So this is the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. It is a multilateral counter-terrorism exercise of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Okay. Next comes, how much FDI is allowed in the telecom sector? So guys, the limit of FDI has been increased in the telecom sector as part of the reforms, as part of the relief measures that have been announced for the telecom sector. We will be looking at the reforms in detail, but only from the perspective of your phase one examination. Okay. So a total of 9 structural reforms have been announced in the telecom sector, but I have taken only 5 because those 5 are the most important. The others are very minor structural reforms that we will be discussing about, of course. But let's first know the answer of this question. What is the FDI limit now in the telecom sector? So it is 100% through automatic route. Earlier it was 49%, but now it has been increased to 100%. Do remember. Okay, so the very first reform is this only, that the FDI limit has been increased in the telecom sector. The next is this. The period, the four, basically, Let me first explain this to you, then you will understand this automatically. Okay, so adjusted gross revenue. You must have come across this adjusted gross revenue when the landmark judgment on it came in 2019. Okay, so I'm not going into detail of this AGR. I'm just telling you what was the dispute about. Okay, so on the one hand, there was central government, and on the other hand, there was telecom operators. The government was saying that the telecom operators will have to give us the percentage of tax, the tax on their adjusted gross revenue, and adjusted gross revenue should be calculated by including their core activities plus their non-core activities. Okay, but what the telecom operators were saying, they were saying that no, our main revenue comes from the telecom activities, and therefore you should consider only core activities to calculate our AGR, and thus you calculate your tax on the core activities and not our overall revenue. Okay, so on this dispute, the central government said that the Supreme Court said that the central government is right, and the telecom operators will have to pay the tax on the entire revenue that they generate from their known core activities as well as from their known core activities. Okay, so that was clear to you. Now, what the government has done? The government has just revised the definition of AGR, and it has removed the non-core activities. Okay, why the government has done so? Because it was very burdensome for the telecom operators like Vodafone, Bharti Airtel, and other telecom operators as well to pay off their dues. Therefore, the government has revised the definition prospectively. That means from now onwards, whatever the tax will be calculated, that will be calculated on the basis of their core activities, not including the non-core activities. Okay, but the dues that have accumulated till now, the telecom operators will have to pay that much. Okay, so that is all about this point. Okay, non-telecom revenues have been excluded. Now, as I said, that the dues that are accumulated so far, the telecom operators will have to pay them. Now, the moratorium on that payment has been set for 4 years. For 4 years, the telecom operators do not need to pay their dues, the dues that have been accumulated due to the dispute in the AGR. Okay, but the interest during that 4 year moratorium period has to be paid by the telecom operators. This is what this point says. Okay, so I hope that both of these points are clear to you. Now let's move on to the next point. This point is different. This is saying that the charges, the interest which was compounded monthly on the spectrum usage charges, will now be compounded annually. So this is another relief for the telecom operators in addition to the lowering of interest rates. So earlier the interest rates were MCLR plus 4%. Now it has been reduced to MCLR plus 2%. MCLR of SBI. Okay, so this is the benchmark. So this is the new interest rate. Additionally, the penalty and interest on penalty has been removed. Okay, spectrum tenure hiked for 30 years. Okay, so earlier the telecom operators used to have spectrum for a certain amount of time, and that period was 20 years. Now it has been hiked to 30 years. Okay. So the lock-in period for spectrum will be 10 years from the date of purchase. Okay, afterwards they can share the spectrum, and there will be no charges on spectrum sharing. So that was another reform announced by the central government. So guys, those were the reforms. Okay, so those were the reforms in the telecom sector that have been announced by the Union Cabinet. But as I told you that I have covered the reforms only from the perspective of phase one, and there were other minor reforms as well. For example, there was one reform related to KYC. The customers who change their SIM, their number from postpaid to prepaid or prepaid to postpaid, had to do KYC separately for both of them. Now that obligation has been removed in order to make it easier for the telecom companies and for the customers as well. Okay, apart from this, as I have already told you, that spectrum charges have been removed. So similar kind of minor relief measures have also been provided, announced for the telecom sector. Okay, so that those are not very important from your exam perspective, because question cannot be made on those minor reforms. Okay. Next comes, which state UT has launched the Mission One Gram Panchayat One DigiPay Sakhi? The right answer is Jammu and Kashmir. Now, what is this? What is this mission about? So this mission is basically the mission to increase the banking in the union territories. Basically, this will provide door-to-door banking services in the remotest villages of Jammu and Kashmir. And how will they do it? They will appoint women of self-help groups, okay, across these states, across the union territory, and they will train the women in the digital banking, and then these women will offer the digital banking services to the people living in remotest villages in the union territory. And this is how the administration of Jammu and Kashmir is planning to spread digital banking across the union territory. Okay, and this will be the door-to-door banking service. So that is all about this Mission One Gram Panchayat One DigiPay Sakhi. So in this one gram panchayat, in one gram panchayat, there would be one DigiPay Sakhi. DigiPay, digital payment Sakhi. So digital banking services will be provided to the people of villages in union territory. Next comes, recently Satish Parekh, who has served as the MD of Ashoka Buildcon, has been appointed as a president of the India chapter of the International Road Federation. The global president of the IRF is Abdullah A. Al Mogbel from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Where is the headquarters of IRF located? US, Germany, Austria, Switzerland, Sweden. Out of this, US is the right answer. So guys, this is the news all about. Okay, now about the International Road Federation, you need to know that the headquarters is in Washington, D.C., U.S. This was established in 1948, and the current president is Abdullah A. Al-Mogbel, who is from Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. So that was all for today. I hope that you have understood the topics that I have taken up in this video. And if you have any problem in understanding any of the topics, then you can ask me in the comment sections below, or you can ask me on the Telegram channel as well that I have mentioned in the beginning of this video. Thank you so much for watching the video, and if you have liked it, then do not forget to share it among your friends as well as subscribe our channel.